A very good morning to all the students. I'm Dr. Prema, Associate Professor in BMS College of Engineering, Bangalore. And we are here to have a course on power quality provided by eShikshana program by VTU. And we are dealing with the course Electrical Power Quality with the course code 18EE825. And I'm here with the third module of the course. And the third module deals with fundamentals of harmonics. This is the fourth lecture we are dealing with. During the first three lectures, we have seen the basic definition of harmonics, what is mean by the voltage and current distortion, and the differences between transient and harmonics. And we also saw how the power quantities in the power system is influenced by harmonics in the system. And we also saw what are the harmonic sequences present. So in the last class, we stopped with the finding out or determining the phase sequences of the harmonics. And today we are going to deal with the significance of triplet harmonics and how to divide and what are the needs of measurement of, what are the measuring quantities of harmonics. And we are also going to identify the harmonic sources in the commercial load. So this is what we are going to deal with in today's lecture, lecture four. So welcome to the lecture four. And I'm just going to have a very short recap of what we have seen in the last lecture, just to have a continuity. And the last lecture, we stopped with the topic, harmonic phase sequences. We saw that in the three-phase system, we have three-phase sequences, positive, negative, and zero sequence. And in positive sequence, the three sinusoidals are displaced by 120 degree and having a phase sequence of A, B, C, or R, Y, B. And in the negative sequence, they are displaced by 120, but they have the opposite phase sequence. And zero sequence, all the three sinusoidals are in phase. And when we talk of harmonics, we can determine the phase sequence of each harmonic component in the waveform. And we also saw that there is a pattern of the phase sequence of harmonics. The fundamental harmonic component will have a phase sequence positive. The second harmonic will have phase sequence negative. And the third harmonic, zero, and then carry on. So this is the harmonic order. This is what we stopped in the last class. So we have the harmonic order. For the first harmonic or the fundamental frequency, we have positive, and the second harmonic negative, and third harmonic sequence, zero. And then four onwards, we have again positive, negative, zero, and this repeat. So this is what we have seen in the last class. We also saw what are the effects of these positive, negative, and zero sequence harmonics in the power system. We saw that all these harmonics create or cause heating in the load, and also the heating is moderate in first harmonic or the positive sequence harmonic, and the heat is excessive in negative, and in third harmonic, if you talk about the zero sequence component, it creates a hot neutral. And the positive sequence components are less harmful, but negative sequence are the most harmful components in the among the harmonics. And zero sequence is mainly responsible for the neutral to earth voltage. So there will be an increased neutral to earth voltage because of the zero sequence component. So this is what we saw in the last class. Today, we are going to start with the topic of triplet harmonics. So when we talk of the triplet harmonic, what I mean by triplet harmonic is the third harmonic component. So we saw that the third harmonic component has a phase sequence zero, right? So let us take the third harmonic component and let us plot the phase, third harmonic component for all the three phases. So if you are taking, you can see that you have a three-phase waveform here. And in the first waveform, we see all the three phase waveforms. And when we see only R phase, we can see that the second waveform, R phase is plotted along with the third harmonic component. So we can see that they are in phase. See this? R phase and the third harmonic are in phase. And in the third waveform, we have Y phase, which is plotted in yellow color. And that is also in phase. The third harmonic component of Y phase is in phase with Y phase. Whereas in the B phase, which is shown in blue color in the fourth waveform. We have the blue phase also in phase with the third harmonic is in phase with the blue phase or B phase. So that, what does this mean? What does this indicate? This indicates that the third harmonic component or any multiple of three harmonic component, which is a multiple of three, say it is third harmonic or sixth harmonic or ninth harmonic or 12th harmonic. So any multiple of three are of zero sequence and they deserve a special consideration because they have a totally different effect in the power system. And they are generally called as triplen harmonic. So you can see that what happens when they all the three phase, the third harmonics are in phase with each other, they add up. So because of that, this triplen harmony become an important issue for grounded star system with the current flowing through the neutral. So what happens when all the three phase are, as shown in figure, you can see that there are three phases and their respective third harmonic component. And because they are in phase, they get added up. And where will they flow? In a star connected system. So we have a star connected system here. And all these three third harmonic components flow through the line and then they reach the neutral. And in the neutral, they get added up. So what happens? All the three harmonic components flow to the neutral and they get summed up and they flow as a total zero sequence current. So what is the effect of it? You are having more current in the neutral. So there are typically two problems which we face due to this triplen harmonic. One is the overloading of neutral because all the three phase third harmonic components are coming and they are getting added up and they are flowing through the neutral. Because of that, the neutral gets overloaded. Also, there will be interference in the telephone wires. Sometimes what happens, sometimes this these instruments or devices, they misoperate because of the line to neutral voltage is badly distorted because of the triplen harmonic. So these are the main effects of triplen harmonic components. We can see in the figure that all the three phase harmonics, third harmonic components gets added up and they fall to the neutral and they flow in the neutral. And because of that, neutral gets overloaded. There will be interference in the telephone wires. And also there is another common problem noticed because of the triplen harmonic is that there's a difference in the neutral to earth voltage. So these are the effects of third harmonic. Now let us see what happens in the transformers when we have triplen harmonic. So in this figure, we are going to see how the harmonic currents are flowing in three-phase transformers with a different configuration of transformers. So in the first figure, we can see a star delta transformer. So we can see here that the transformer winding connect, the primary is a star connected and the secondary is delta connected. Why we are talking about this is the transformer winding connection have a significant impact on the flow of triplen harmonic. So that winding, actually the transformer winding decides how the triplen harmonics are flowing in the circuit. So we are seeing two cases here. In the first case, we are seeing a star delta transformer. That is the primary is connected in star and the secondary is connected in delta. And what happens, what the arrows shows that the triplen harmonics are flowing. So initially the triplen harmonics flow through the line and they get added up in the neutral. And you can see that there are three arrows in the neutral. What does that mean? All the three phase triplen harmonic currents are flowing, getting added up and they're flowing to the neutral connection. And then in the secondary, what happens? Because you have a delta connection in the secondary, there is no neutral. These harmonic currents, they are flowing in the delta winding. And what happens in the, they get trapped in the delta connection itself. They don't flow out because there is no neutral. It doesn't get added up and they don't flow out. And they get trapped in the delta and they keep circulating in the delta connection itself. Now, what is the advantage of this? The advantage is that they remain trapped in the delta and they will not flow in the line currents in the delta set. So in the secondary side of the transformer, the neutral currents are not flowing out. There is no neutral, there is no common connection, and they don't get added up, whereas they trap in the delta connection itself and they don't throw to the line. They don't add to the line current. That is the advantage of this kind of connection. So when the currents are totally balanced, in a balanced system, when the currents are balanced, the triple and harmonic currents behave exactly like zero sequence. In fact, we have seen that triple and harmonics are zero sequence currents. And when in a balanced system, they typically act as a zero sequence current. And this type of transformer connection, that is star in the primary and delta in the secondary, delta we are connecting mainly to avoid the triple and harmonic flowing to the line current. Okay, so this type of transformer connection is most commonly employed in the utility distribution substation, where the delta winding will be connected to the transmission feed. So in the distribution substation, the transmission feed, you have the delta connection, so that the neutral or the zero sequence current or the triple and harmonic current doesn't flow to the line part. And there is one more type of connection, which is star-star. So what is the advantage of this star-star? The grounded star connection. Here star is grounded, you can say. The grounded star connection allows balanced triplets to flow from low voltage to the high voltage. So what happens is, here in the primary also, it gets added up and it goes to the neutral. And in the secondary side, what happens? It gets equally distributed to all the lines. You can see the arrow going outward. So here the triple and harmonic flow to the line, but they get equally distributed. So they will be present in all the three lines in equal proportion. So you, in the cases where you cannot avoid the triple and harmonic, this will happen, where you can distribute all the triple and harmonic current to all the three lines so that they don't get added up. Many of the loads are generally connected in star-star combination because it gets equally distributed. So in the distribution transformers, towards the transmission line, we connect a star-delta transformer. And in the load side, generally we get star-star connection. The advantage is that though there is a triple and harmonic current, in the secondary side, the current gets distributed to all the three lines equally. Okay, so these are the two types of connection where the triple and harmonic flow. And this is taken because the transformer windings have a significant impact on the flow of triple and harmonic. I hope this is clear to you. We will go on to the next topic, which is harmonic index. So what is meant by indices? They are the numbers or they are the parameters which are used to measure the harmonics in the system. So now we know that there are distortions, and the distortions are mainly caused by the nonlinear load. So when you have nonlinear load, there is a distortion in the voltage and the current waveform. Because of that, we have many other integer multiple or fundamental frequency present in the system. They are called harmonics. Now, when we have harmonics, we should have a measure of it. We should know how much harmonic of what is the amplitude of each of these harmonic components present in the system. Why do we want to know that? Only then we can have a measure of it, and only then we can have some measures to mitigate this harmonic. Only when we know how much is present, then we can design accordingly so that we can mitigate it, right? So there are mainly two quantities, or two measures, you can say, which are used to measure the harmonic. They are called the total harmonic distortion, and another parameter is total demand distortion. So we have two parameters or two measuring quantities which are used to measure the amount of harmonic present in the system. They are called THD and TDD. THD is total harmonic distortion, and TDD is total demand distortion. Both are the measures for effective value of a waveform only. So what do you mean by effective value? The RMS value. So both THD and TDD are used to measure the RMS value of any harmonic component in the system. So you can see the measurement of or the formula for calculating THD. THD is square root of the summation of all the harmonics present other than one. So you can see that in the summation, we have summation H greater than 1 to H max. So what does it mean? We are not taking the fundamental component. We are taking only the harmonic component in the numerator. And we are taking the effective value of all the harmonics other than the fundamental quantity in this. So here we have in the numerator of a THD expression, we have summation of H greater than 1 to H max. Suppose if you have five harmonic components present in the system. So we have V1, V2, V3, V4, and V5, right? So in the numerator, we will take the effective value of 2 to 5. We will eliminate the fundamental and we are going to find out the effect of the effective value of all the harmonic present component present to the fundamental quantity, or it is a ratio of all the harmonic are present in the system with respect to the fundamental harmonic. So generally we will express in terms of a percentage of that, how much percentage of other quantities are present in terms of fundamental. So it is a relative quantity. So we have numerator, we have the effective value of all the harmonic components present and divided by M1, where M1 is the RMS value of the fundamental component, where MH is called the RMS value of the Hth harmonic. So if H is equal to 5, it is the fifth. MH will be RMS value of the fifth harmonic. And how do you calculate the RMS value? It is the summation of H from 1 to H max MS square. So it is nothing but M1 plus THD. So M1 square root of 1 plus THD square will be the total RMS parameter of the quantity. So what is the indication or what's the significance of this? The THD will provide an idea about how much extra heat is realized when the distorted waveform is applied. So when we have a distorted waveform, the any quantity which is other than the fundamental quantity contributes to the heating of the waveform, right? So how much extra heat is produced in the waveform because of the harmonics? So THD is giving you an idea of that. It can give you an indication of the additional losses caused by the harmonics present. So it is giving you an idea of extra heat produced or the additional losses which are caused by the current flowing through the conductor, like extra because if it is distorted. But anyway, this is a very good parameter to measure the voltage harmonic present in the system. But it is not a good quantity when we come to the current to the system. So for voltage harmonics or voltage stress within a capacitor, or how much is the voltage this harmonic, what is the contribution of the harmonics in the voltages, we can make use of THD or total harmonic distortion. So generally we will say 3% THD or 5% THD, or if you say 30% THD, what does it mean? 30% of the entire current is or the waveform is contributed by the harmonics in the system, which is very bad. So the higher the THD is, worse the system, or more the harmonic components present in the system. So if you say the THD is 1%, only 1% of the entire thing is contributed by the harmonic. So this is generally a good quantity for measuring the voltage harmonics in the system. And we have a waveform. The figure shows the voltage THD variation over 1 week. Generally, we take 1 week because 1 day or a few hours will not be enough to determine the actual THD in the system. Generally, we can see that there is a pattern for the THD for the same load. If you are applying or if you are calculating the THD of a same load, then we can see that it follows a certain pattern. So this is this particular waveform is plotted for a 13.2 kV substation when applied to a residential load. And you can see that this is in the x-axis, you can see the day here, Monday to Sunday. It is plotted from Monday to Sunday. And you can see that during night time, the THD voltage harmonics is higher than the early morning, because the non-linear loads are relatively high compared to the amount of linear loads during this hour. So because of that, you can see that the pattern has more higher harmonics in the night time. See, you can see the 3%. Maximum is 3%, and it's varying from around 3.5% to 1.5%. And because the load pattern is the same in the residential load, we have the same pattern followed in the entire week. Generally, a one-week observation period is best to observe the a meaningful THD pattern in the system. So this is giving you an idea of how the THD varies over time for a particular load. So this is plotted for one single residential or a group of residential loads. So because of that, you have a pattern. Now, if you are extending it, you can see that the pattern varies. You can see here that during Sunday, it is slightly less. You can see the variation of the THD over various days of loads. Now, let us see the second quantity, which is called total demand distortion. Look at the definition. What is the difference? You can observe the difference in the formula. What is it? In THD, we had written MS, which is mainly voltage. But in TDD, we have this is particularly for current. So we have the same expression given, H is equal to 2. Here it is given H is equal to 2. Summation, H is equal to 2 to H max. Or you are taking all the components other than the fundamental frequency and taking the RMS value of it, which is in the numerator. And in the denominator, we have the total current in the total RMS current in the system. So why are we taking TDD for current and THD for voltage? What happens when we talk of voltage? There isn't much fluctuation in the voltage. So voltage, we know that the supply voltage in India is 230 volt in single phase, and there is no much variation in the voltage actually happen. But if you take the current, a harmonic current of 1 ampere will be 10 times if the fundamental is 10 ampere, right? So if you have a fundamental current of 10 ampere, and if you have the effective harmonic current of 1 ampere, then the TDD is, or if you take the THD, it is 10% if the fundamental is 10 ampere. Now, if you are taking a fundamental current of 100 ampere, then it will be only 1%. So if you are taking it with respect to the fundamental quantity, for voltages, it is okay, because voltage does not vary much. But if you are taking current, and if you are measuring it with respect to the fundamental current, there will be a large variation. But if you are measuring it for the entire load current, there won't be much variation. So it is meaningful to take it in this way than taking it with respect to the fundamental component. That is why we generally take TDD for measuring the harmonic current in the system. So these are the two main harmonic indices we talk of. Generally, when we talk of harmonic, we say that, okay, it has a THD of 5% or a THD of 3%. And when we talk of current harmonic, we generally take TDD into consideration. So this is about the fundamentals of harmonics. So here we have seen how harmonics are produced and how we can calculate the harmonics, what is the actual meaning of harmonics. And then we also saw how the harmonics is affecting the fundamental parameters like active power, reactive power, etc. And we also saw how the harmonic, various components of harmonic, especially the triplet harmonic, affect the system current and how it is flowing through the different configurations of transformer winding. Then we finally saw how we can measure the harmonic quantities. We generally measure the harmonic quantity with two parameters. One is THD and one is TDD. THD is with respect to the fundamental quantity. Generally, we use it for voltage harmonic calculations, and TDD is with respect to the total current in the system. So it is used for measuring the current harmonic in the system. So now we have seen the fundamental concept of harmonics, and we are going to move on and we are going to see how the harmonics are affected in the commercial loads, how the harmonics are in the residential loads, and how they are in the industrial loads. We are going to see all the type of loads and how they are going to create harmonic and how the loads are getting affected by harmonics. Both we are going to see. Okay. So it is the application side, and we will be taking some case studies also, and we will see how harmonics are affected or how harmonics are produced. First, we will see how harmonics are produced because of various loads. We know that harmonics are basically produced by nonlinear loads, right? So we will take different type of nonlinear loads and see how they act as harmonic sources. And then we will see different types of loads and see how they are affected by the harmonics in the system. So the next part of the third unit or third module will be about the application or the generation of harmonics due to various loads. So first let us take how the harmonic sources are from commercial loads. Commercial facilities. What do you mean by commercial facilities? Examples are office complexes, department stores, hospitals. Then what else we have? We have now internet data centers. All these are commercial loads, and they are dominated by high frequency nonlinear loads such as computers. If you take any office complexes, or if you take internet data centers, they have computer loads, right? And they also have, they're flooded with fluorescent lighting, and they have more of electronic ballast, or they have adjustable speed drive, and it is for air conditioning, elevator, or sensitive electronic equipment. If you take anything in any of these commercial loads, they are flooded with nonlinear loads. So now we are going to see how all these loads, commercial loads, are acting as sources of harmonics. We know that in commercial loads, we have a lot of nonlinear loads. So we have seen some examples. We have computers, typical nonlinear load. We have fluorescent lighting, which is another typical nonlinear load. So there are many loads. There are adjustable speed drives for motor control, for elevator application. So for all these, we have nonlinear loads. And depending upon the type of the load, different type of loads, they are all harmonic currents. All these harmonic currents from all these loads gets added up, or they can even cancel each other. See, depending upon whether they are of same sequence or opposite sequence, they get added up or they get canceled depending upon the load. And the voltage distortion level will depend on both the circuit impedance and overall harmonic current distortion. So you can consider, because it is flowing through the power system, the harmonic voltage distortion, we have seen this, right? Voltage distortion mainly depends upon the circuit impedance and the level of distortion of the current. The level of distortion of the current depends on the load. Now, since there are power factor capacitors also in the power system, right? And so, since these power factor correction capacitors are not used in commercial facilities, the circuit impedance will be dominated by the inductance. And they are dominated by the service transformers and conductor impedances only. So they are mainly inductive in nature. Therefore, voltage distortion will be estimated by multiplying the current by the impedance adjusted by the frequency. So we have the circuit impedance and we have the current distortion. We multiply that, we get the voltage, the amount of voltage distortion present in the commercial load. So now let us see what are the different type of commercial loads available. So the most commonly used commercial load is a single phase power supply. So most of the commercial buildings will have power supply, and they will have mostly they'll have switch mode power supply. And what do they do? The DC power from a microprocessor based office equipment is commonly derived from the single phase or full bridge rectifier. So what do we have the power supply? Power supplies are generally giving DC load, DC output from the AC. So we will have rectifiers. Either we will have full bridge rectifiers or half wave rectifiers. Depending upon that, we will have a waveform, whether it is a full wave rectified or half wave rectified, whatever it is, they are distorted waveform, and then because of that, there are harmonics present in the system. Now, let us go to the circuit of a switch mode power supply. So what we can see is input is either 120 volt AC or 230 volt AC, and that will be rectified with a bridge diode rectifier, and then it is filtered by a filter capacitor, and then we have the control circuit, and from there, ultimately, you have a DC to DC supply where this is mainly used to step down or step up the voltage, and we are using high frequency transformers here, and then using the high frequency transformer, either we will have a buck converter or boost converter or buck boost converter, where the output voltage will be adjusted, and you will have a various levels of DC output voltage. So this is the basic circuit of a switch mode power supply, where your input voltage is AC and output voltage will be different levels of DC. Let us see how the harmonic, the current and voltage, the THD or the plot will be for the switch mode power supply. So what we have is in input, we have a sinusoidal voltage, right? Then we have a rectified one. This is a full bridge rectifier. So in the rectifier, you will have full bridge rectifier, and then you have the capacitor, which will be filtering. And then we have the switch mode power supply here, which will have a pulsed output waveform, increased level or reduced level, depending upon whether you are using buck or boost. And then finally, we will have another rectifier and get a continuous DC. So let us see how the waveforms are for this switch mode power supply. See here, you can see that it is plotted. The load current is plotted in the first waveform, and second is giving you the harmonic components. This is the frequency spectrum. The second is the frequency spectrum, and first one is the plot of current. So you can see that the current is definitely distorted. And what do you observe from the frequency response? You can say that the fundamentally here you have the frequency in the x-axis is plotted with respect to frequency, and around 50 hertz, which is a fundamental component, you have the maximum amplitude, which is 60 ampere. So the load is 60 ampere for the fundamental component, and then we have the third harmonic, which is around 150. So you can see that in the x-axis around 150, you have the third harmonic, and then all even harmonics are eliminated here. And you can see that you have only odd harmonic components present in the system. And a distinctive characteristic of this switch mode power supply is that it will have a very high third harmonic current. See here, first fundamental component has only 60 ampere, whereas your third harmonic component is 40 ampere. So in most of the power supplies, the third harmonic component will be high magnitude. When we design a filter, we should take care of this and see that we'll be eliminating the third harmonic component so that you are eliminating maximum harmonic component from the system. So this is about the switch mode power supply. Now let us here we are going to see different type of loads and see how the harmonic components are there in each of these loads. Now, if you take the case of a fluorescent lighting, we know that fluorescent lights are discharge lamps, and they require a ballast to provide a high initial voltage to initiate the discharge of the electric current to flow between the two electrodes. So you have two electrodes and you need a discharge current to flow between the two electrodes. The discharge is established. What happens? The voltage will reduce and the arc current will increase. And there will be a short circuit between the two electrodes. And then what happens? The ballast has to quickly reduce the current to a level to maintain the specific lumen output. So that is how you are getting the fluorescent lamp functioning. So you have to see that how the current is suddenly increasing and then it is reducing to maintain the lighting. And when we talk of fluorescent, depending upon the type of ballast, we can have two type of ballast in the fluorescent lighting. One is magnetic and one is electronic. So in a standard magnetic ballast, it is made up of iron core transformer and a capacitor encased in the insulating material. And generally, this magnetic ballast will be operating at a fundamental frequency of 50 hertz or 60 hertz. And the iron core magnetic ballast will contribute an additional heat loss, which will make insufficient compared to the electronic ballast. So nowadays, mostly electronic ballast is used because of the losses which are produced by the electronic magnetic ballast. So in electronic ballast, it will be operated at a very high frequency, not the fundamental frequency. It will be operated at around 25 to 40 hertz frequency. And it has two advantages. One is that the size of the inductor is very less because you will be using ferrite core for high frequency operations and for high frequency inductances or any magnetic material. And because of that, your size will be very small. And the second advantage is that the high frequency eliminates the flicker associated with iron core magnet. So in iron core magnet, you will have a flicker which can be totally eliminated in the high frequency application. Now let us see how the currents are produced in the magnetic as well as electronic. So in magnetic ballast, you can see that the current is almost sinusoidal. Because there is no electronic component present in it, you can see that it is almost sinusoidal. And if you see the frequency spectrum, the fundamental is maximum, and then there the other frequency components are almost negligible compared to the fundamental. So this gives a better harmonic response place of electronic. Let us see electronic also. So magnetic is better in case of harmonic. But generally, we are not using magnetic ballast because of the losses associated with it. Now, if you just take the electronic ballast, fluorescent lamp with an electronic ballast, you can see that the current is almost pulsed, right? In the positive half cycle, you get a pulse, and negative half cycle, you get another pulse. Because of this, the harmonic distortion is also very high in the case of electronic ballast. You can see that in the magnetic spectrum, almost all the frequency components are significantly present in the magnetic spectrum. So generally, an electronic ballast produces a THD in the range of 10 to 32%, which is very high. According to the standards also, this 10 to 32% is very high. And generally, we will have some kind of mitigation techniques which will be applied, which we'll be dealing with later. So this is just a comparison of how the different fluorescent lamps work in terms of frequency. Now, let us take one more example of an adjustable speed drive. So what is an adjustable speed drive? It is basically the converters, power converters, which are used to control the speed of a motor, right? Generally, it is found in elevator motors, pumps, fans, and in HVAC systems, where we have to control the speed of the motor. Now, whether you have a DC motor or an AC motor, depending upon that, your power converter also will be different. And basically, all these adjustable speed drives will have a power converter, which will be converting AC voltage into a fixed AC voltage into a variable AC voltage. Basically, we are adjusting the AC voltage so that you can adjust the speed of the motor. So this adjustable speed drives also give a significant effect in the distortion, because they will also have, because they have a power converter used, they will also have the harmonics present in the system. So now, so let us just have a recap of what we have seen in this class. First, we saw the effect of triplet harmonics in the system, how the triplet harmonics are flowing. Then we saw the measuring harmonic measuring parameters, which are THD and TDD, total harmonic distortion and total demand distortion. Then we slowly moved on to the different type of commercial loads, which are the sources of harmonics. So main commercial loads what we have are the fluorescent lamp, then we have the adjustable speed drive, and then we have power supply. So we saw how a power supply or SMPC contribute to the harmonics in the system. We saw the frequency response, or we saw the harmonic generation, the amount of harmonic generation in SMPC. We saw how it is in the magnetic ballast and how it is in the electronic ballast in the case of fluorescent lamp. So if you come to the fluorescent lamp, magnetic ballast has less harmonic components than electronic ballast, where electronic ballast has almost THD of 32%. And we also saw that adjustable speed drive also will give significant contribution to the harmonics. So that is what is for today. We will, in the next class, we will see more of this, more of the commercial loads and industrial loads, which are actually the harmonic source. Thank you.